are all together because we sit together in heavenly places in Him. My place in Christ is the same as your place in Christ. Now this matters not what your background was. It matters not what you've done in the past. It matters not where you've been or how you got here. What matters is that when you obey the gospel by the grace of God, you got the same seat in Him as everybody else. The Bible says that in ages to come, He might show the exceeding riches of His grace in kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And so the Bible indicates that God grants us grace. But not only does God grant us grace, but we gain as a result of grace. In other words, because of God's grace, we have gained the opportunity to become the righteousness of God. Romans chapter 5 and beginning at verse number 19. Because of that grace, I have become the righteousness of God. Romans chapter 5 and beginning at verse number 19. The Bible indicates, for as by one man's disobedience that many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound, that as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. It is because of this grace that I have become the righteousness of God. I'm not right because I was always right in and of myself. I'm not right because I did all the right things at the right time. I'm right because I obeyed God, and because I obeyed God, I became the righteousness of God. Right. That's why Paul indicates here that the more sin abounded, the more grace God gave to outweigh the effects of sin. And so because God kept giving me grace, I became the righteousness of Him. God, my friends, grants us grace. We gain as a result of grace. And then lastly, grace brings about more grace. That's been the subject ever since I've been talking here this afternoon. The central message of this passage is that because of God's saving grace, we have access to His sustaining grace. Romans chapter 6 and beginning at verse number 14, the Bible informs us that sin shall not have dominion over us, because we are not under the law, but we are under grace. Paul asks the question, what then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? Paul answers that question by saying, God forbid. He says, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, His servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Paul said, but God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. He said, being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. What the Bible indicates unto us is that the grace of God brings about more grace. It was the fact that individuals had lended themselves as servants of sin, but the grace of God came along and helped us out of that pitiable state. Paul said, what took me from being a servant of sin to being a servant of righteousness is that God gave me a plan to obey. And when I obey from the heart, that form of doctrine that had been delivered unto me by God's word, he said, I changed my state from a servant of sin to a servant of righteousness. And in this we see that it is the grace of God that brings about more grace. No wonder the songwriter indicated that it was amazing grace. And he said, when I talked about it, how sweet it sounded. Because I started to realize that it saved a wretch like me. I noticed that I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. Just how good is the grace of God? The grace of God is so good that it can take a murderer and turn him into a missionary. The grace of God is so good it can take a drunkard and turn him into a deacon. The grace of God is so good it can take an extortioner and turn him into an elder. The grace of God is so good it can take a whoremonger and turn him into a worshiper. The grace of God is so good it can take a pimp and turn him into a preacher. The grace of God is so powerful that it can reach into the deepest innocences of man's heart and cause him to realize just how much God wants to be with him. And when he responds to God in obedience, God will change his life so that what he has become now is much better than what he's ever been. And that's why we learn to appreciate the grace of God. Just how sweet is it when you look back over the annals of time? Even the Old Testament men started to understand something about the grace of God. When you notice that in the midst of the world being filled with violence, when every thought and the imagination of man's heart was only evil on a continuous basis, when God had repented that he even made man on the earth and had decided that my spirit is not always going to strive with man, yet I'm going to give him 120 more years to get himself together. The Bible says in the midst of all that, that God looked upon Noah and that Noah found grace in the eyes of God. Not only did Noah find grace in the eyes of God, but when you look at how good God's grace is, the Bible indicates that he was a rainbow unto Noah, promising that the world wouldn't be flooded with water anymore for man's sake. But not only was he Abraham, was he Noah's rainbow, but he was Abraham's ram. When Abraham needed a substitute, when God had asked for Isaac as a burnt offering, Abraham got up early the next morning and he took the boy, he took the wood and the fire and started making his way up toward Mount Moriah. It was Isaac that asked him, Daddy, I see the wood. He said, Daddy, I see the fire, but where is the sacrifice? That's when Abraham said, son, that God will provide for us a sacrifice. And the Bible informs us that Abraham tied Isaac down to the wood, took a knife up in his hand, and was about to pierce his son through. But it was the grace of God that had a ram in the thickets and told Abraham not to harm his son, because now God recognizes that you trust him and only him. Not only was he a ram to Abraham, but when Jacob was on his journey, Jacob had run away from home because big brother Esau said he was going to get him. He had stole his birthright and then he stole his blessing. In the midst of Jacob running hither and yonder, trying to avoid the wrath of Esau, he laid down one night on a pillar of a stone. And that's when God gave him a vision, set up a ladder that reached from earth to heaven. And he watched angels ascending and descending on that. That's when Jacob said that if God will be my God and will bring me safe on my journey, then I'll save him all the days of my life.